Michael, how are you?
Look at that. Look at your background. You've got it perfect, haven't you?
Tom, how are you?
Yeah, very good, thank you.
Hey, Tim, are you here, my friend? We're back again.
I'm in. Are you there?
Bravo.
Timu, firstly, actually, I want to know about the javelin. And I don't know whether you see the way I went like that, because that's a true javelin grip. The javelin there, you took that to the training ground. Was that sensible and safe?
Yeah, sensible, but safe, I don't know. I was aiming some guys, but I didn't touch them, luckily. But
yeah.
It was one of those training balls that we actually, you know, javelin is a big thing in Finland, so I had to show them everybody who was the best.
Did anybody beat you? Did anybody get near you?
No, not really.
Really? Is that the truth?
That's very true.
Okay. Let's speak to you, Robbo. From all the times that I've spoken to you and interviewed you at White Hart Lane, you always seem the absolute professional, speak well. But, you know, what were you like behind the scenes? You're a bit of a practical joker. Is that true?
I mean, we used to get up to all kinds of stuff. I remember I used to nick the groundsman's tractors on regular occurrences at the training ground. I remember once I nicked, you know, the white line markers when they mark the pitch.
Yeah, yeah.
They used to pull the hair out of me. They used to go mad because I'd drive the tractors where we used to train at Chigwell. They used to leave the keys in the tractors and they used to drive to the far end of the training ground and just drive through the conifers and leave them in the field at the back. And the poor ground staff couldn't find the tractors for hours. And then they left the line marker out once when we'd finished training. So I just took it for a walk around the grounds with pride and joy.
Who would tell you off? I mean, would anybody take your side, or being who you were, you could do whatever you wanted to?
It was all in the line of banter. It was humour. You wouldn't take it to levels where you'd end up getting in trouble. I mean, amongst the lads, there was a level of banter and there's a level of humour. And it's just all part of being at the training ground and being a professional. But there's a line, like anything in life, there's a line. There's a practical joke and then there's taking it too far.
Well, you obviously drew the line with your white line marker at the time and just knew...
Several.
Well, let's speak to Dawes, Michael Dawson. So when you take over as captain, do you find it's a different level of responsibility? You're looking after everybody. Everybody comes to you. It's much different from when you're just another regular member of the playing staff.
I mean, look, I'd been captain at Forest from the age of 18, and I look back and think, wow, that's young to be leading the team. When you were in that dressing room, you had so many egos, some world-class players, and you had to deal with some of these off the field and think, yeah, how do I deal with them?
Like what, though? What would you have to deal with? What sort of things would a captain have to deal with? And also, you're having to deal with egos, etc. Like, what do you mean?
Youngsters like Tom and Aaron moving down at 18 and a load of money on flash cars causing carnage.
This is a very open one, and anybody can pick up on this. What's the funniest thing you've seen on a football pitch?
Best one's corners, standing on the feet, standing on the toes. I used to get centre forwards when I was younger, you know, come in standing on you to stop you coming out for the cross. Stand on your feet and it's cold and put the studs on top through your laces. It used to drive me mad. But as you get older and more experienced, you end up doing it back to them. So it's one way of keeping away from you. Kevin Nolan at Bolton used to do it all the time. Remember the set pieces under Sam Allardyce there? Yeah. And at West Ham as well, they used to do it. They used to come try and put you off in the box and just stand on your toe, and it absolutely killed. And there was nothing you could do because obviously the ref's not going to see it.
Let's talk about managers and some of the managers you played under. One day, Ramos, let's go with you here, Tom. He came in and there was the story everywhere that all of a sudden food had to change. Is it true? You know, no tomato sauce, you weren't allowed this, weren't allowed that. How true is that?
Yeah, I said it in an interview, sort of tongue-in-cheek, about the ketchup thing, which just seemed to stick with me for
about
15 years. But yeah, he cut out like butter, all the sauces on your pastas and stuff like that, and made it quite basic and bland. When managers come in, they always have one thing in their mind, and it was sort of, I don't know, the diet or the fitness of the squad.
It is one. Perks of the job. Now, obviously, it's a job that everybody would dream of. You're playing professional football in the Premier League, especially playing for Spurs. But what's the best part of it for you, and perks away from the actual football itself, that you could go, yeah, that's because of what I was doing that I managed to do that?
Free kit, free golf clubs.
Yeah?
Yeah. All the kit you used to get, used to kit the family out and all the kit. I think my dad still rocks around in half of my training kit and England jackets that I used to get.
It soon dries up though when you finish from all those, doesn't it?
It don't for me, mate. They stop sending you stuff.
Oh yeah, it's not for me, yeah. And I'm still playing there so long ago.
What about you, Tom? Perks of the job. What is it, getting into places for free wherever you go? You can book a table, you can do whatever you like, you get recognised everywhere?
Yeah, it comes with obviously the territory of playing at a massive club like Spurs. In the Premier League regular, you got entry into a few places, not queuing at a lot of places.
No matter what you've got, there's never nothing anything better than a nice free pair of trainers or a free pair of boots or a trackie turning up in a package at the training
ground. Free stuff. It's all about the free stuff. What about when you're playing for the club and there's famous fans and people that you'd know and you don't actually, you know, does it ever seem surprising that how do they know who I am?
I had one at Chigwell where I was like, I went home and told the wife and she was like, what? Jude Law. He came down to the training ground and had a photo. Oh, yeah. And it was like, what? You met Jude Law? And I think I probably must have put it on my phone somewhere. And I was like, wow, that was one where I think people were like, all right, fair play. That was great to see people come down to the training ground, someone as big as him. It was wow.
Right, here's one. Let's go with you, Timo, for this one. If you weren't a footballer, what career path? I mean, this is that old thing that used to be in Shoot magazine. And if you weren't a footballer, what would you be? What would you have ended up doing?
Looking myself.
Apart from javelin thrower, of course.
Looking myself at the camera, top model, probably. I would love to be a golfer, professional golfer.
Wait, is that realistic, or what would have happened, do you think?
Yeah, my last round was pretty good, so that's really real.
Okay.
It only stopped snowing there last week.
I don't know. In Finland, when you stop your school, some people keep reading to be a lawyer or whatever. I went to a cooking school, so probably now I would have my own Michelin star restaurant. You never know.
So you reached the FA Cup final, but it's moved to the same date as of your wedding. Which one would you move?
I wouldn't be stupid enough to book the wedding on the cup final. I wouldn't be stupid enough to get married. Football, definitely.
Easy question, Paul. Marriage can always wait. Marriage can always wait.
I did kind of expect that everybody would say this. Right, worst trainer. Who was the worst trainer at the training ground? Who was the one that used to try and get away with doing as little as possible?
Pascal, for me.
I was waiting for someone to speak. Roy Keane told us a story when he was at Forest, when he went to Sunderland. He'd had his hair braided, and he said to Roy, who was manager at the time, he went, Gaffer, I've had my hair done yesterday, I can't head the ball. That summed Chim up in one thing. That going to Roy Keane, imagine telling him that, Gaffer, I'm not heading the ball today. What a guy though, what a guy.
Joe, finally, greatest game playing for Tottenham Hotspur. Greatest memory you've got playing for Spurs?
I'm going to be greedy, mate. I say it's the best time of my career that I had at Spurs. I'm going to pick three moments. I can't just pick one.
Go for it.
My birthday, when I ran out on the whole of Park Lane, started singing happy birthday to me. I mean, I've still got that banner now. And that just brought shivers down the back of your neck. The goal for me, obviously, something special that I remember forever. Still got all the kit that I scored that goal in and the football. Literally everything. My dad's got everything. And the cup final. Something that you dream of as a kid. It's an old cliche, but to climb those steps at Wembley and to lift the trophy, for me, a club that meant so much to me, and it was something special.